A warm welcome to today's webinar on the Renon Build tool. I hope you can all hear me. Otherwise, please briefly let us know if there's any technical issues. My name is Sophia Stock. I'm working at Adelphi in Berlin. We are one of the implementing partners of the Renon Build project. And before introducing my colleagues who are also here with us today, and before taking a look at the agenda, I'd like to briefly point to today's netiquette. Please stay muted while listening to the webinar inputs. But if you want to speak up, which we would very much like you to encourage to do later on, please use the raise hand function. You can find it behind the reactions button, which is the little smiley in the bottom toolbar on your screen. And as soon as you raise your hand, we'll be able to unmute you so you can speak up and we'll all be able to hear you. And finally, we'd like to encourage you to use the chat function. You should be able to find the chat in the bottom right corner of your screen. For any questions or comments you may have, please also post questions during the inputs if you want to. We'll try to closely monitor the chat and then make sure that your questions will be addressed in the discussion session at the end. Next slide, please. Thanks. As you can see, today's agenda envisages four parts of this webinar. After the moderator's welcome, my colleague David from Creare will take over to briefly introduce the Renon Build project. And then the main inputs on the tool will be given by Vincenzo Bianco from University of Genoa. Of course, both institutions are also implementing partners of the Renon Build project. But for all further information on the project and then on the tool, I'd like to now hand over to my colleagues, Vincenzo and David. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you very much, Sophia, for this brief introduction. Well, as Sophia said, my name is David Perez. I work for Creare, part of the consortium taking care of this project, Renon Build. This is a research project financed by the European Commission. There are essentially four countries participating in this. There are four focus countries for this project, which are Germany, Spain, Italy, and Lithuania, and which started in 2019. So the project has been running for almost 3 years and is about to finish in this year, 2022. The project, as you, I guess most of you are aware, is about the development and implementation of on-build schemes. So essentially, can you make next slide, please, Roberta. On-build schemes, most of you are aware, of course, but just to give a very quick update or explanation about on-build schemes, essentially it's like a business model or like a scheme in which the utility is a little bit in the center of energy renovation for dwellings, essentially domestic consumers, and the consumer pays for those renovations with an on-build scheme. So essentially, he's paying a little bit of money every month in the bill of electricity for that specific dwelling, for that specific house. In the screen, there could be several models. I included the option in which the utility somehow is supported by a financial institution, providing mainly debt, could be also in some cases equity, to finance these energy renovations. This is the overall, let's say, understanding of on-build schemes. I'm not going to get deeper in greater detail. Of course, there are several reports and studies we have produced and published in the website of the project, which you can see at the bottom of the slides, renonbuild.eu. Next slide, please. Yes. Okay, so this webinar is about a tool. During the project, we produced a tool which we called Energy Renovation Valuation Tool, which is essentially tool assessing specific energy renovation investments. So essentially, it could be, I mean, typically it would be a utility when a utility wants to plan an energy renovation within a certain group of consumers, domestic consumers, the tool, the characteristics of this group of consumers could be inserted in the tool, and then the tool produces an assessment about how good this investment is. And this assessment is based on economic, let's say, parameters, but also non-economic ones. And this, well, what Vincenzo is going to do over the next 30 minutes or so is explain to all of us how this tool works in greater detail. The tool is available for all of you for free. It is online. You can access it in the Renonville website. The instructions to access the tool is available. What else? I mean, it's also open source, so you can modify or change whatever you need in case you need to make additions or to change it. And we hope it is useful for your renovation plans. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much to everyone again, and I leave the floor then to Vincenzo.
Thank you. Thank you, David. So just a very quick addition to what you told. The tool will be available in the next week. So it's right now it's not available. It will be available on the repository GitHub, which is free accessible by everybody. And obviously you will find all the instruction to install your to install the tool. You can install on a local machine or on a server-based facility, so more people can access and use the tool. As David told, the tool is open source, so you can use it, modify it if necessary, etc. Today, I'll show you a quasi-final version of the tool, since we firmly believed in this tool, and so we decided to make some extension with respect to the original version we imagined for this tool. But let me explain you which is the main objective of this software. So the main idea is that if large renovation packages for buildings must be implemented, it is necessary to have a clear understanding of which could be the performance of this renovation package. Performance from two points of view, namely the energy points of view, because we want some energy savings, and the energy savings are closely connected with the environmental impact that the building stock we are going to renovate can have. So we can improve the let me say the environmental footprint of this building stock from one side. But from the other side, since on-bill financing or on-bill repayment approaches, or in general on-bill schemes, as you saw, are based on, let me say, private finance. So in the general framework, there is not any public interventions. It means that these measures must be profitable by themselves. And so it is very important to analyze the profitability of these investments. And it's important for both utilities and financial institutions to create bundle of investments, which means groups of buildings to renovate maybe in different parts of our countries, in order to find the optimal mix for this investment campaign. Next chart, please. So the Renonville tool is imagined as a connection between the different modules. So there is an engineering part, financial part, a risk assessment part that you see in the chart as a credit rating module, plus we have a part related to the non-energy benefits assessments, plus we decided to introduce something more related to the business modeling and to the creation of, let me say, a rough business plan for the cases you want to analyze. So in the engineering module, there is the calculation of the energy parameters of the building. So by using the common energy balance equation, we are going to estimate the energy consumption of the bundle of buildings we are considering before the renovation and after the renovation, so that the energy efficiency can be estimated. Also, we have a database with the climatic parameters. This database is completely accessible and you can integrate with the locations you need. And based on this input, we can calculate the primary energy savings. Once primary energy savings are determined, the financial analysis can be developed because there is a clear understanding of the CAPEX, which depends on the engineering measures you want to implement, and there is also a clear estimation of the possible cash flow, because cash flow for energy efficiency interventions is given by the savings on the energy bills. So one element for this calculation is the energy savings, and another element is the evolution of the energy price, of the fuel price you are using, for example, natural gas, fuel oil, biomass, etc. Let me say that this is a classical approach to the estimation of energy efficiency, but which is the drawback? The drawback is that to do these calculations, usually deterministic approaches are used, but as you can easily imagine, most of these parameters, most of the parameters entering into these estimations are not deterministic, are very far to be deterministic, but they are probabilistic. First of all, weather data. We know that weather conditions are highly volatile, and so if we use average weather conditions, we are using a rough approximation. Instead, if we use a probabilistic approach and we add the uncertainties with respect to the average weather conditions, a better description can be obtained. Similar observations can be made also for other parameters. For example, U values of existing buildings are known till a certain extent, because these are estimations. We don't have the specific measurements, but we have estimations, and so a certain degree of uncertainty is present. Even more for the energy price, because the evolution of energy price is something very complex to predict, and it is very complicated to predict over a long term, like energy efficiency investments require. And so for the energy price, the probabilistic analysis is even more important, I would say. Next chart, please. Okay, so if we go deeper inside the engineering calculation module, basically we have three streams of information to provide, which are the climatic data, the buildings archetypes, and definition of the interventions. I think that climatic data and interventions are clear for everybody. Instead, let me focus on the concept of buildings archetypes, because If we walk on the street, we can see that the buildings are different one from the other. But in order to summarize the building stock in significant categories, archetypes can be defined. The archetypes is the categorization of buildings according to some main features that we can use. In our case, we defined these archetypes by exploiting the Tabula project, which is a previous European project where this categorization of archetypes was studied. And in particular, one of the main parameters which is significant for us is the age of construction, because according to the age of construction, there is a change in the construction practice and also a change with respect to the measures taken to improve the energy performance of the building. So you have that the most modern buildings are clearly more performant from the energy point of view, whereas buildings built, for example, in the period of the 60s, 70s and so on are less performant from the energy point of view. And so we in the Renom Build tool, we used these archetypes categorization to represent the building stock. Next chart, please. So you can see that the concept of the archetypes is to move from a large number of buildings to categorize according to some uniform features and obtain a limited number of different typologies that can be easily analyzed. This approach can be sometimes used in terms of districts within a city, because you have that more or less within the same districts, most of buildings are built during the same period. And so this could be easier for the users, for utilities or financial institutions to aggregate the investment and to focus on specific areas and so on. And so a large set of buildings can be easily analyzed. Obviously, this approach contains a certain degree of approximation, because we are not modeling each buildings individually, okay? And this approach is more tailored, the detailed simulation of the building for design purposes. Here we are at an evaluation stage of of large investment over a building stock. We are not conducting, we are not thinking to make like energy auditing procedures. So it's something that must be done quite quickly in order to make a pre-feasibility analysis. Let me see. Next chart, please. Then in the financial calculation modules, we have the input for the classical financial parameters like the rate, the evolution of the energy cost, the CPI index, etc. And on the basis of the input and of the calculation executed in the engineering module, there will be the estimation of the typical financial indexes like NPV, IRR, payback period, etc. But the difference between this tool and the other existing packages is that here you don't get an individual NPV or a single value IRR, but you will get a statistical distribution of NPV. And so to each value of NPV, you may associate a significance level, a probability level. And these will allow you to estimate the risk of loss, the risk of having a negative NPV, for example. Third, we have a qualitative evaluation of non-energy benefits. we will see during the demonstration. The validation is qualitative in the sense that by answering to some qualitative statements and by assigning qualitative answers to this statement, finally you will get a quantitative estimation of the energy benefits. So the methodology is qualitative, but then the evaluation is quantitative. And this is an easy way in order to include non-energy benefits valuation in the overall analysis of the investment. Non-energy benefits are the benefits linked to energy efficiency investment, but they are not directly related with the saving of energy. For example, if we make an energy renovation, we will have an improving the comfort of our flat. So this is a non-energy benefits because you will not save money on the bill for the increase in the comfort, but still the increase in the comfort is an extra benefit you obtain. Next chart, please. Okay, so the probabilistic approach is developed through the Monte Carlo analysis, and it is based on the estimation of the so-called debt risk matrix. And if we go to the next chart, we can see the definition of value at risk according to the paper. You can see on energy policy, you can see it on the screen. And so we can estimate the value at risk connected to all the variables we are considering. So you can estimate the energy efficiency at risk, the NPV at risk, the IRR at risk, and so on. Next chart. Okay, you will find all the analytical details of the methodology in this paper, which is open access, so freely accessible at the link you can see on the screen. So if you want to have the details of the calculations, you can consult this paper, and you will find everything in terms of equation, etc., in case you want to reproduce the methodology. Now, after this relatively brief introduction on the concept of the tool, let's see how it appears from the practical point of view. So let me share the screen so we can go to the tool. Okay, so this is the tool as it appears after you enter in it. So you can have a server-based access where you have a login and password and you enter in the link, or if you have it installed locally, you need to open your browser, and through the browser you will access it. You will receive all the instructions for the installations. So here you can click on add project to create a new project, right? Let me call it Renon Bill, for example, and click on save. So now you create your project and we can go to the definition of the parameters by clicking on open here. Okay, so here we can set the units of measures we want. This is a megajoule per square meter, megajoule, this is kilowatt hour per square meter, and this is a kilowatt hour. So this is the case definition, where we need to define our case, and we click on add case. So if we click at the case here, we can define the location of the buildings we want to analyze, and then we can define the technical features of our building. So let's choose Italy, for example, and here you have a database with a set of Italian cities together with their climatic conditions. Okay, So, for example, let's assume to analyze the city of Bologna. You have a different building type. We have apartment, multi-story, and detached house. So if we say apartment, for example, we want to analyze 50 apartments located in Bologna. And in the case of the apartment, we need to define also the floor position. If it's a middle, I mean, an apartment between in between other two apartments, if it's the top floor or the ground floor, because from the energy point of view, this is relevant. Let's suppose middle floor, and here we have the archetypes. As you can see, for Italy, we have this division in archetypes in this time period. In other countries, it can be different because the change in the construction approaches could be happened in different years. Let's suppose that these buildings were built in the 60s. Let's suppose that their floor area is 19 square meters. And now let's choose which kind of measure we want to make. For example, the current condition, let's suppose that we have an individual burner per each flat for making hot water and heating. And let's suppose to substitute it with a condensing boiler. Let's suppose that we are going to substitute also the radiators, so the emitters. And let's suppose to use radiators with the thermostatic valve, which help us to save energy. So this is a very simple measure. And then the discount rate, let's assume that is 88% in our case. And here we have some commercial indications, but let's consider it later on if we have time, because it's a secondary in terms of importance. So we can click on save. And so we have the first case. Apartments in Bologna. Then we want to make, we want to add to this project other cases, like, for example, let's suppose to go to Bergamo and to make the refurbishment of multi-story buildings. So here, if we say 30 or 20, this is the number of buildings we are going to renovate. Let's suppose that the period is this one, 61-75. Let's suppose that the floor area this time of the building is 450 square meters, and let's suppose that each building has 5 floors. Now, in this case, let's suppose that we are going to install insulation on the building. So we want to install wall insulation and roof insulation and floor insulation. Okay. Done. Then okay. Then we want also to install a more performant windows, and so here that we have the transmittance for a single glazed windows. Let's suppose to improve it to 3, so it's more performant. This is the ratio between the window surface to the floor surface. Unit of measure here are watt per square meter Celsius. So done. Discount rate, let's assume that it's the same, and let's save this case as well. Okay, so this is these two cases are part of the same investment strategy, let me say. And here you can see some initial estimation. in terms of NPV and NPV per square meters, IRR, etc. But these are deterministic estimation. Then let's suppose to consider the city of Agrigento, which is in the south of Italy. Case. Let's put detached house, 10 houses, same building period. And let's consider to install the insulation also here. Okay, so the city of Agrigento is much warmer with respect to the other two locations, Bologna and Bergamo. And so, as you can see, you have a negative NPV. You can immediately check. But so this is the definition. Then here you have the energy estimation. Energy estimation that are developed on this configuration, and you can see that if you flag one of these three, the number changed. Why? Because when you flag here, you have the values related to the single case. If you unflag, you have the total number related to the sum of these three cases, which are considered as a unique project. So now we can move to the engineering analysis, and here we can go to the Monte Carlo setup. You have a simplified setup and an advanced setup. In the advanced setup, you can change all the possible parameters. Okay, so here we have the uncertainties, for example, on the thermal transmittance of the wall, plus or minus 20%. We can set an uncertainty of plus or minus 20% on the windows, or we can put 22%. Then we can put an uncertainty on the of the 15% on the heating degree days. We can put an uncertainty on the fixed cost of our investment, because maybe it's just an estimation, and so we can consider an uncertainty of plus or minus 10%. You can flag all of them if you want. Clearly, you will have a result affected by a very large amount of uncertainty. So here you can set the uncertainties on the fuel price. This is the uncertainty in the first year of estimation. This is the uncertainty over the last year of the estimation, and the intermediate in the intermediate 3 years, there will be a linear interpolation. We can take it. Also here you can decide which kind of shape should the noise have: Gaussian, triangular, uniform, etc. Let's take it Gaussian and let's click on save. Here you have the number of extraction that the Monte Carlo analysis will make. Let's write 1000. We want the results in terms of current energy consumption, plan energy consumption of a plan and configuration, or in terms of savings. Let's save it in terms of savings. I run the Monte Carlo, and now sometimes it's necessary to make this 1000 estimation. And here you will see the results in terms of Gaussian visualization. You can see that in terms of electric consumption, we don't have anything, because we didn't, our measures did not affect energy consumption. So here you have, for example, the total energy savings that we expect, and here there is the level of uncertainties. This is just for indication, the expected savings on the bill of the first years. And here you can see the value at risk of the energy savings and the condition at the value at risk for the energy saving. You can refer to the definition of VAR and CVAR that you can find on the paper. Then, once that the engineering analysis is performed, we can move to the financial analysis. So this is immediately the static visualization of the financial parameter of the NPV. You can see that this is the NPV, 4.9 million. This is the value of the IRR, the profitability index, the simple payback, the discounted payback, and so on. But these are the deterministic estimation. We can make the Monte Carlo analysis. Now we cannot set the number of runs because the number of runs was already set in the engineering analysis. So we cannot change. If we want to change and we want to make more than 1,000 extractions, we should come back to the engineering analysis, make more of 1,000 extractions, and then come here and to run the financial analysis. So now the financial analysis is running. We need some seconds to get the results. Clearly consider that I am using it on a server-based version, so the tool is installed on a server and I am I'm connected as a client. If you install locally, depending on the power of your machine, the calculations can be also much faster. So this is the level, the NPV. You can see that here we have a distribution of the NPV with the associated level of probability. So this is the average NPV, this is the 5% and 95%. I mean, this is, you can see as the center value of the Gaussian, and these are the two extreme values at 5% significance. And here you have the distribution. So you can see that this is the expected values of the NPV, and this is the values at 95% confidence. And the same for all the other parameters. Then you have the VAR, VAR and the CVAR analysis for the NPV, IRR and discounted payback period. In this case, we have no loss risk because in all the cases, we have that the NPV will be positive. We don't have cases where the NPV is negative. And so, the loss of risk in this case is zero. What you have is the risk of having an NPV which is lower than what expected, but not negative. Here there is the part related to the energy benefit. So you need to answer to this statement qualitatively. First, you can adjust the weight of these statements. Here we attributed one to all of them. And by answering to this question, for example, energy expenses represent an important part of household income. You agree at what extent? Medium, high, low, fully agree, and etc. So for this case in the city of Bologna, let me say 75 here, 25 here, 100 here, etc. You make update and you will find the evaluations in terms of energy benefits. If you consult the project deliverables, you will find the theoretical background for this methodology. So basically, according to these statements, we will add in terms of energy benefits a certain part of the investment which is making. There are some references. If you go to the report we have on the website, but if you are interested, you can ask. I can provide you the correct references for the theoretical background. The theoretical background is very simple: is that one part or the 100% of the investment cost can be charged on the value of the apartment in terms of non-energy benefits. It's a simple way to account for the energy benefits because the estimation of the energy benefits could be very complicated and you would need a very large samples of investment to make this evaluation because you need to analyze how much the real estate market recognize for non-energy benefits due to energy efficiency investment. What we assume here is that the maximum that the market can recognize to you is the investment cost in energy efficiency you made. Because if the values is higher, there is no convenience in recognizing to you this non-energy benefit, but it's better from the economic point of view to buy an apartment to renovate, make the renovation and get the energy benefits and the non-energy benefit because it will be less expensive. Anyway, if you want, I can provide you the correct, the specific theoretical reference for this. This is an addition we wanted to make because especially for the utilities it can be very important, not specifically for investment valuations rather than for marketing reasons, because you can communicate to your clients not only the savings they can obtain on the bill but also the increase of value of their property, the possible increase of value of their property. Then this is a section we are finalizing, which is related to the calculation of the on bill amount to pay in order to obtain this renovation. And here you have reporting features because you can download the CS book with the analysis you make. And so here you have the summary of the results you get. Also you can if we go back home, you can export your case, you can save it, and then you can also share with other people. You can make import project, select the file and reopen in it. So it's quite flexible from this point of view. I'm thinking if there are other features to explain. For example, here is very important because here you have the background data. So if you download this file, you can see the database behind the tool. So these are all input that are used in the calculations that you can update. For example, we made some calculations related to the city of Agrigento, which is located in Sicily. You have the 18 degree days. Okay, this is just an information we reported for completeness, the climatic zone. This is the period of heating. And then you have the average daily solar radiation on the south surface for all the months of the year. So if here you want to add a new location located in Italy, I don't know, the city of, here we have all the provinces for the for Italy, but let's suppose that you want to add another cities which is not a province, I don't know, the island of Capri, which is very famous. We don't have it here, so we need to add. So if we have the climatic data for the island of Capri, we can simply add here a new line with the country Italy, city Capri, the corresponding high degree day, heating degree days, and the corresponding solar radiation. Then here we have the thermal data related to the building categories. As I told you, have the wall transmittance, roof, floor, etc. So if you want to change the building archetypes, you can make, you can simply add and delete row and make different aggregation. For example, this is what we have for Italy, and this is instead what we have for Lithuania. And you can see that we have different features, or what we have for Spain, or what we have for Germany. Here you have the standard values used for thermal conduct, for insulation of wall, roof, floor, etc. We have the material cost, installation cost. Obviously, here you can modify everything according to the location where you are, according to your needs, etc. Here you have the definition of the heating plants, the efficiencies, the cost, and so on. And you can again define as you think is better. These are other thermal data that are used in the calculations. Here you have the variable cost, so a question on the fuel cost. For example, here we have the cost of the electricity, the cost of natural gas, the cost of the pellet, and the discount rate that you can also modify by the guy. And here you need to introduce the evolution of the energy cost for 30 years, if it's necessary to analyze, to make the analysis for 30 years, or you can extend if you necessitate more years. When you make the calculation of the NPV, it is asked for how long, how many years you should consider in the calculation of the NPV. So what you make in terms of uncertainties, you need to provide the uncertainty in the first year, and then the uncertainty on the price on the over the last year, and in between, linear interpolation of the uncertainties is estimated. I think that more or less it's all for the.
Vincenzo, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think it would be good to maybe if we came to an end with the inputs soonish, because we already have some questions in the chat, and I'd really like
yeah,
to
yeah,
give participants
I think
the
we,
possibility
we are fine. We are fine. We are fine. The with the with the presentation. I mean, it was just an overview, and then the tool will be released in the next weeks with the. With the user guide and the precise indications. Here it was just to give a brief introduction and overview of the possible capabilities that this tool can have. Also, I would leave the details to the guidelines that we will release, where you will find the precise interpretations for all the parameters. So if maybe we have some questions, we can try to answer.
Thanks a lot, Vincenzo. We do indeed already have 6 questions in the chat. Would you like to take maybe 2 questions at a time? I can read them to you and then we move on to the next 2 questions.
Okay.
So the first question would be, is this tool for use at the level of individual houses or at the level of complete portfolio? And then the second question, is DRV2 applicable to public buildings as well? Are there assumptions that may prohibit or limit the reliability of the tool for public buildings?
Okay, I mean, let me say that the tool is conceived for not for the single house analysis, but if you gain confidence on how to use it, you can also use it for the single house. You need to be, let me say, smart in using it, so you need to gain some confidence. But if you check the theoretical paper and you can see the equation, the equations are exactly the same that you apply to a single building or to a set of buildings. But in the single buildings, you have to be more precise in attributing some specific parameters, because if you analyze one single building, it is supposed that you want to make a more precise analysis, and so you need to be specific in the, in some of the coefficients you use, because in this case, in order to consider a large set of buildings, we used some average coefficients in some parts. In the individual building, you have to be very precise. As for the public buildings, it's a similar answer, in the sense that the only hypothesis that could affect the application to public buildings is the average consumption of domestic hot water we considered for a single person, and the air change coefficient that can be different for public buildings. So once you gain practice in using the tool, you can, with some you know, little modification to the input parameters, you can use it also for public buildings. I mean, the concept is the same. Heat is exchanged by conduction, convection, and radiation in public buildings rather than dwellings. And it is true for single house analysis rather than for a bundle of investments. So the basics are the same in all these cases. And so, since this tool is physically grounded, you know, it starts from the physics of the buildings, and we don't we didn't apply any specific hypothesis, but we simply developed a thermal modeling of the building. It's quite flexible in its application, even though it was primarily developed for households applications, but with some slightly, you know, modifications, you can easily extend the utilization.
Thanks, Vincenzo. I think we quickly forward with the next questions, maybe a block of 3 this time because they're rather short. First question, are there any plausibility checks in the background? Second question, is CapEx defined automatically by the system once you select the type of renovation? And then the third question would be, is the tool restricted to specific countries? Does it apply for Greece, for example?
I start from the last one. When I show you the tool with the different countries, and I discussed it and told that you can add more cities and so on, the same, you can add more countries, just you need to add just more lines. You add more lines with your country, with the archetypes of the country defined as I showed you in the tool, and you can apply to any country, also Brazil. I don't know, it's not limited to the European Union, provided that you are able to furnish the meteo data and all the necessary input, so you can easily extend to other countries. Then, which was the... Can you repeat me the first 2 questions?
Sure. There was a question about plausibility checks in the background, and
what checks? Probability check.
Plausibility checks.
What do you mean for plausibility check? I mean, we did a validation of the tool. You can find it in the paper. So we compared the results of our tool with the results of other analyses available in the literature. From the points of the energy analysis, I would say yes, we did a plausibility check, but it's not a matter of checking. It's a matter that we used the first law of thermodynamics as a theoretical basis, which is valid till now. So we didn't apply specific hypothesis. We just modeled the buildings as resistances, as thermal resistances, which is an approach very well established in the literature and in the practice. So the methodology is fully validated. Then we validated the results of the tool because we did some hypothesis on the values of some coefficient, and we wanted to test how much these values could affect the estimations. And so just that, but the methodology is of course validated, and we didn't validate it, it's validated automatically because we used a very well established methodology. But you can refer to the paper for all these details. You will find a chapter on the validation of the tool. And Sophia, the other question?
Yeah, the other question was on capital expenditures. Is CapEx defined automatically by the system once you select the type of renovation?
Yes, it's automatically estimated in the sense that in the background, as I show you in the database, you define the specific CapEx per each intervention. I don't know, for example, the cost of insulation per square meters and thickness, the cost of the radiators per kilowatt, and so on. So when you define the interventions, the amount of insulation which is needed, the power of the radiators which is needed, is automatically calculated, and so the capex is the total capex is automatically calculated starting from the specific values you put as an input in the database.
Thanks. Then the next question to you, Vincenzo, would be on to what extent different stakeholders have been taken into account in the model, for example, whose risk and profitability has been calculated, taking, for instance, into account private homeowners versus utilities, financial institutions.
No, can you repeat because I couldn't get it?
Yeah, I think it was referring to something you said. The quote would be market reflects higher prices for energy efficient buildings. And then the question is, how have you taken into account the different stakeholders in this model? For instance, whose risk and profitability is calculated, taking into account private homeowners versus utilities and maybe financial institutions?
I mean, we didn't take into account this. In what sense? I mean, in my analysis, I didn't take into account, I didn't made specific analysis on if I was an utility or if I was a financial institution. But if it depends on the perspective on how you use the tool, because, for example, if you are a financial institution, maybe you are interested in better understanding which is the risk or which should be the remuneration for the capital you lend. And so you want to make, for example, some probabilistic analysis, more detailed probabilistic analysis on the other rates or on the discount rates. You can try to estimate the maximum discount rates you can apply for specific loans, etc. Because there is also a functionality where you can add you can evaluate the investment by adding on a loan. Obviously, in half an hour, I just gave a brief overview, but I would say that it's quite versatile. So you can use it with your different perspectives. I saw a question now appearing about the cash flows. Now cash flows are estimated. cash flows are estimated, and so you can make the evaluation. If we calculate the NPV, we need the cash flows to estimate the NPV. Okay, then.
We have another technical question in the chat, and maybe it makes sense, Vincenzo, if you directly go to the chat. It's the third last entry. It's a question from Mr. Rodriguez from EIB. I think it makes more sense if you read it than me reading it out to you.
Market reflects higher price for...
Before that one. It starts with, it's a more technical question.
A more technical. One of the biggest uncertainties in residential building energy is related to the influence that users can have on influencing the real energy. It doesn't, so no, we didn't consider the user behavior, but I mean, we didn't consider directly, but to my point of view, if you want, you can include this estimation by, let me say, playing with the uncertainties definition, because finally, which is the impact of the behavior of people behavior, the impact of people behavior is in the energy consumption. And if you add the statistical noise, not on the or on the people behavior, but on everything that is around the people, finally you get the same results. What you would need to do this is to check in the literature, to check studies which gives you an estimation of which is the impact in terms of noise, so in terms of uncertainties of the energy consumption of people behavior. And so you can add also these uncertainties, and you can include these uncertainties in many of the technical parameters, because finally it will be an impact on the energy consumption. So it's not directly included, but to my point of view, you can find a strategy to include it.
Thanks a lot, Vincenzo. There has just been a reaction to this question, but since we are already past four, I would suggest to come to an end here. Thanks a lot, first of all, to all of you for listening in, and thanks of course for all your questions. It's been very interesting to see your reactions and to discuss a bit with you. Before saying goodbye, I'd briefly like to point to the next activities we have in the project. As we said, the project is still running until the end of April, and we do have some more activities and publications on our to-do lists. For example, the next publication is going to be on a guideline on on-bill business model development, specifically to be used for utilities, for instance. Then we are going to publish national roadmaps for on-bill replication in the four focus countries that we've been working on. And in April, we'll have the final conference of the project. I hope you enjoyed today's webinar. Thanks a lot again for your very good participation. I see there have been a lot of questions coming in, and I can say we are all happy to stay in touch. So if you have any more questions, please reach out to Vincenzo, to any of the other project partners, and we'll be happy to keep on discussing via email, etc. And we all look forward to exchanging with you again, or to continue exchanging with you. Having said that, thanks again for your attendance. Have a good day, everyone, and goodbye. See you soon.
Bye-bye. Goodbye.